everyone. Welcome to City Talk. I'm Thermise Bevel. The Atlanta City Council approved Mayor Kasim Reed's $567 million budget by a vote of 14-1. The budget emphasizes the mayor's commitment to public safety, economic development, and youth development. Code enforcement will get $4.7 million to address blighted properties. The budget also includes funding to expand IT systems to support the 311 call center and the 911 center. $5.7 million will be directed to the reserve fund, which currently sits at $137 million. Council President Cesar Mitchell applauds the City Council's decision to pass a new urban agriculture ordinance, which will allow communities to have access to healthy, nutritious food. The council president says the passage of this legislation is a great step forward for the city of Atlanta. He says urban agriculture increases food safety, fosters educational opportunities, creates jobs, and expands local economic development.
Is that it really provides an opportunity to create jobs. It's also an opportunity for young people to learn more about how to produce food for themselves. And when you can produce your own food, you certainly will be able to survive when it comes to nutrition and really feeding yourself and your family. And that's an important thing for our young people to learn and to grasp. But beyond the whole idea of creating jobs, this is really an economic development opportunity for our city as well. And so I'm excited about the economic impact that this ordinance can have on our city.
Being able to sell on site gives Atlantans healthier options and access to fresh, locally grown produce in places where there are supermarket shortages.
But we also have right now in our city the emergence of individuals and communities that are growing their own food and their own produce. And so when you can grow your produce literally in your community, the distance of time or the distance between that food being produced and taken out of the ground and it reaching your table to be consumed is much shorter. And that's a much healthier option for our citizens.
The legislation also creates a framework for urban gardens to be placed in underutilized lots.
This ordinance will really provide the space and the opportunity for individuals and for local communities to take those vacant spaces, those vacant properties, and make them food producing. I think that's a win-win for the community.
Mitchell says this is a great step towards making Atlanta clean, green, safe, and thriving. Councilmember Cleta Winslow and quite a few others turned out for Neighbor Works, a day of volunteer service at Venetian Hills Elementary School. Volunteers transformed this neighborhood school into a space for students to learn and grow. The community effort included landscaping the front of the school, refurbishing garden beds, reconditioning the outdoor classroom, restoring picnic tables, and painting the cafeteria.
Nothing's more important than to have a great neighborhood school and have it send a message to the neighborhood that the shrubbery looks nice, that the playground looks nice, that we've got a community garden with sunflowers coming up. And it is just fabulous that all the volunteers that have come out that are really making a difference.
Members from Atlanta Neighborhood Development Partnership, resources for residents and communities, and other civic groups all pitched in to help. They were hip, cool, and green out in Grant Park for the Atlanta Green Fest. The festival focused on connecting going green with a young, cool-minded crowd to create a unique experience. The afternoon featured live performances, fitness demonstrations, free health screenings, community outreach, and a small business street market. The group says who knew going green could be so cool. Councilmember Howard Shook is pleased that the Georgia 400 MARTA pedestrian bridge is open to the public. The project was part of a list of conditions Councilman Shook championed as a neighborhood leader. And after taking office in 2002, he continued to fight for the project. The $32 million pedestrian bridge spans Georgia 400, joining two disconnected quadrants and creating a new entrance to the Buckhead MARTA station. Officials with the Buckhead Community Improvement District say the bridge will provide more than 3,000 people who live, work, shop, and worship in the area with a more practical rail transit alternative.
This is a project that's going to connect the east and west sides of Buckhead and create much greater pedestrian access, which will in turn spur more ridership for MARTA and, very importantly, help the environment and overall the overall quality of life for this entire region.
We are so proud of MARTA's accomplishment working with the community partners in designing and executing this fabulous structure.
A recent report out of George Washington University lists Atlanta as a walkable urban environment. The metro area ranks 8th in the nation due to an increase of places in a safe walking distance to population centers. Atlanta's Office of Sustainability says the credit goes to several agencies that work together to make the city a more pedestrian-friendly environment. The ranking is a 180-degree reversal from an earlier report. The professor who authored the study was the same researcher who called Atlanta Sprawl Anta 20 years ago. The Atlanta Regional Commission and national experts in the concept of tactical urbanism demonstrated what a lifelong community might look like. They temporarily transformed two blocks of Auburn Avenue in the Old Fourth Ward into a place that allows young and old to live well and age in place. Many older adults are looking for a more walkable and bikeable community with close shopping and nice amenities. The temporary transformation included public art, entertainment, transportation, and more.
So we're here in Old Fourth Ward in District 5 having an opportunity for neighbors and guests to see the possibilities. We have pop-up shops, we have food trucks, we have a lot of opportunities for neighbors to talk to each other and to see what they want to do about a aging in place dynamic in the city of Atlanta.
The Sweet Auburn Street Transformation is the culmination of a multi-year project to create age-friendly places. The City of Atlanta will hold a code enforcement summit August 16th at 9 a.m. at the Atlanta Civic Center to explain the procedure involved in restoring distressed properties and the importance of community involvement in reporting these issues. Questions and concerns about existing code or zoning violations will also be addressed. For more information, call 404-330-6044. Friendship Baptist Church held its Men's Day program, and President Mitchell was the guest speaker. The annual celebration pays tribute to Friendship's fathers, brothers, and sons. The men of Friendship work to inspire youth and to continue the traditions of that Christian institution. Friendship Baptist Church was established in 1862 and was Atlanta's first Black Baptist autonomous congregation. Friendship held its final service at its Mitchell Street location back in May. The congregation is moving to a new church home to make way for the new Atlanta Falcons Stadium. Councilman Ivory Lee Young Jr. was a speaker at the prayer breakfast. Atlanta firefighters and EMS personnel gathered at North Atlanta High School for National Fire and EMS Safety Stand Down Week.
Fire departments around the country are focusing on behaviors and risk associated with line of duty deaths and injuries.
The audience heard from members of the Charleston, South Carolina and Toledo, Ohio fire departments. In 2007, 9 firefighters in Charleston died in the line of duty, while 2 from Toledo were killed last year. This was a chance for Atlanta's first responders to hear firsthand about what went wrong and how they can learn from those sacrifices.
It really means a lot to them coming from someone who is still a captain in their fire department in the trenches doing what they do every day. It's a lot better coming from him than it would be coming from me when he says all the things that he's saying from their perspective.
The event ended with the reading of the names of those 11 firefighters. Atlanta's Hard Rock Cafe thanked the city's first responders with 71-cent burgers. It was the chain's birthday. Hard Rock was founded in 1971. The day included a burger eating contest between members of Atlanta's public safety agencies and the Atlanta ambassadors. Teams had 8 minutes to eat 20 mini burgers, with the winners taking home the Hard Rock Founders Day Burger Eating Champion Trophy.
I am honored. Yes, set, and go!
To celebrate our 71 birth year, we give back to Atlanta's heroes, police, firefighters, EMTs, and offer our legendary burgers all day long for only 71 cents, which is something really proud of to do to support those who protect and serve and support us throughout the year.
Congratulations, Atlanta Fire Rescue. They chomped on enough burgers to beat out the other teams. Atlantans lace up their sneakers for the downtown dash. And Deputy Commissioner Tim Borchers is here to talk about the Atlanta streetcar. Stay with us.
ATL 26, forward together. Channel 26 brings the City of Atlanta home to you. Atlanta City leaders want to move the city forward together with you. The goal? To engage and empower citizens through service. From City Hall to the neighborhoods that make Atlanta unique, ATL 26 keeps you connected to your government and community. And we go global. As Hartsfield-Jackson Atlanta International Airport takes you around the world, ATL 26, forward together.
Deputy Commissioner Tim Borchers is with us today to talk about the Atlanta Streetcar. It's a pleasure to have you. Thank you for being here.
Thank you, Themis.
The first of the new streetcars arrived back in February, and the last concrete pour was at the intersection of Peachtree Street and Auburn Avenue. So give us a little history of the Atlanta Streetcar.
Well, we haven't seen streetcars running in Atlanta for 65 years now. That's when the last streetcar closed down. Just over a year ago, the streetcar construction began. And yes, the infrastructure's finished. The track, the overhead wire, the overhead contact system, and also the maintenance facility with all the vehicles. So we begin commissioning and testing and training of operations, a soft opening, and then a full opening later this year.
The streetcar will add a new form of transit downtown. What are some of the benefits of the system?
You know, a streetcar is a walkability extender. Everywhere it operates, it extends walkability. And that's important nowadays, so people can actually see it, and walking's becoming so much more popular. It's also providing transit and transportation for visitors, families, mum and dads and the kids coming to visit Atlanta, conventioners who typically arrive at the airport, catch MARTA in, and are looking for transportation, a way to see the town and spend their money. Also for commuters, people who are now choosing to live and work downtown. It helps them get around. In fact, they can survive without a motor car. And also people in the hospitality industry who are working in the hotels and restaurants and living nearby, a way for them to get to work.
Talk about safety. What are some of the things we should know?
You know, streetcars are very, very quiet. And with anything that's quiet, you need to be aware of them. When you're downtown, you also need to be aware of motor cars, cyclists, motorcycles. So it's important to look and listen. Look up, don't look down, look around in the environment, and also listen. Ear pods are becoming a big distraction and a cause of many accidents with motor cars, as well as cycles, as well as streetcars. So look and listen for the streetcar. Always be aware. It does move at about the same speed as regular traffic. So just keeping an eye on your surroundings.
The streetcar runs east to west for 2.7 miles. Tell us about the route. Where does it go?
It's a 2.7 mile circular route. It connects downtown Atlanta near Centennial Park, a range of attractions and hotels, right through to the Martin Luther King Jr. historical area, which has a lot of local culture, a lot of local music, and a lot of local restaurants.
How much does it cost, and what are the hours of operation?
The fare structure for the first 3 months will be free, and this is a gift to the businesses which have received some inconvenience during construction time so they can get a boost to their businesses. Also so locals can get to use, bring the families along without having to pay anything and get to use and experience the streetcar. Now after the first 3 months it will be $1 the first time you ride it, $1 the second, and if you pay $3 or more the rest of the day is free. It operates 7 days a week from early in the morning, so you can catch it to work. It has extra services at lunchtime and dinner time, and then runs till later in the evening. On the weekends, up to 12, midnight, 1 o'clock.
Sounds great. Thank you so much, Tim Borchers.
Thank you.
Those in Oakland City enjoyed a nice evening outside watching a great Disney movie. And the District 9 Divas put on quite a show. Back in a moment.
ATL 26, forward together.
The Georgia Aquarium, the World of Coke, Zoo Atlanta. These are just a few of the attractions here in Atlanta that draw millions of tourists to the city. Now Atlanta has a new museum that offers up lots of nostalgia. Delta Airlines celebrated 85 years of passenger air flight in style. The airline giant reopened the newly renovated Delta Flight Museum.
Happy birthday, Delta. Let's let the room hear it. Delta flew its first flight out of Atlanta in 1930. In 1941, moved its headquarters from Monroe, Louisiana, to the city of Atlanta. And since that time, Delta's relationship with our city has climbed higher and higher.
Mayor Reed joined Delta CEO Richard Anderson and Governor Nathan Deal, who applauded Delta's impact on passenger flight and the carrier's role in the community.
You are a symbol of prosperity in our state. You bring people from all over the world here to Atlanta, and they are made familiar with what the great state of Georgia has to offer. And this will be a continuation of that.
Aviation enthusiasts will love the Delta Flight Museum, which is located in the airline's original headquarters next to Hartsfield-Jackson Atlanta International Airport and is open 6 days a week. Kids on summer vacation got their blood pumping during Kids at Play. It's a program by Parks and Recreation to get kids off the couch and active. Every day for 3 hours, instructors lead their charges through exercises, sports, fitness demonstrations, and more. Kids at Play runs from June 4th until July 23rd on Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays. You can take your child to Collier Park, English Park, Reverend James Orange Park, Perkerson Park, or Zabin Recreation Center at Eastlake Park to let them play. Mayor Reed made a stop at the Children's Museum of Atlanta to read Amari's Bike Adventure to a group of kids. It's part of his summer reading club, which encourages children to read throughout the summer when school is out. The kids were taught a song and dance to go along with the story.
As she began her second lap, she ran over a rock on the ground and crashed, this time scraping her cute little knees.
The Diabetes Association of Atlanta continued its tradition of the Downtown Dash for Diabetes. Councilmember Joy Shepherd led the City of Atlanta team, and she encouraged everyone to sign up and get moving. The event raises funds to provide medical assistance, diabetes screenings, and education to the uninsured and the underinsured in Metro Atlanta. Those in District 4 enjoyed a movie in the park. Councilwoman Cleta Winslow invited the community to Reverend James Orange Park in Oakland City to watch Disney's The Emperor's New Groove. Constituents brought blankets and folding chairs for an evening of outdoor fun and to see the movie Under the Stars. It's about a teenager who is transformed into a llama by an evil witch. The film was nominated for an Academy Award for Best Original Song for My Funny Friend and Me, performed by Sting. Lawn chairs in the park. Residents joined Councilmember Felicia Moore and the District 9 Divas for a jazz concert in Grove Park. It was an afternoon of cool, smooth jazz with live performances by Gwen Hughes, Valerie Bell Smith, Kimberly Paulette, and Judith Franklin.
We certainly thank the Bureau of Cultural Affairs for doing this because it does give an opportunity to bring the big jazz event to a smaller venue in the park where the residents can come and enjoy good music.
Great news for the deepening of the Port of Savannah. And they were in full swing at the Mayor's Cup Golf Tournament. That's next.
ATL 26, forward together. Covering Atlanta inside City Hall and out in the community. Keeping you connected to the people who are making a difference. Transforming lives through service and giving. ATL 26, forward together.
President Barack Obama signed off on the Water Resources Reform and Development Act. That means the deepening of the Port of Savannah can move forward. However, this year's bill does not include federal funding. The Army Corps of Engineers and the state still need to come to terms on the details of the project. Georgia's Port Authority director said that could come in the next few months. The project is expected to cost $652 million, with the state contributing $266 million. Hundreds of boats converged on the Chattahoochee River for the Chattahoochee River Race and Festival. 300 boats raced down the waterway to the awaiting festival at the finish line where food and music met them. The yearly event is sponsored by the Chattahoochee Riverkeeper.
Well, Chattahoochee Riverkeeper is the only nonprofit solely dedicated to protecting the Chattahoochee River, which is our drinking water for Atlanta. So this is important to spread awareness about what our mission is.
Boaters floated in the river after crossing the finish line where they enjoyed a cool glass of iced tea.
Yeah, it was just a lot of fun, coming out here and getting out in nature and getting some exercise, some sun, looking at wildlife. It's just a relaxing experience.
The world's largest organization dedicated to volunteer service converged on Atlanta for its national conference. Points of Light encourages millions to take action through volunteer service. Their concept is changing the world.
The Georgia Road Congress Center was the site of the annual Points of Light National Conference on Volunteering and Service. It brought together more than 5,000 service leaders to learn and nurture new ideas for volunteerism. Neil Bush is chairman of the board for Points of Light.
Points of Light was inspired by my dad's convention speech and then many speeches as president, where he referred to the constellation of stars, thousands of points of light, who are doing great things in communities all over America to try to solve community problems. And these great organizations are powered by volunteers.
Volunteers that Neil Bush estimates to be 65 million Americans strong, who can be found giving their time all over the country.
Our conference kind of blows wind into the sails of our movement. And so more companies, more faith organizations, more youth organizations are sending people into the community to solve problems that are intractable.
Mayor Kasim Reed welcomed those who heed the call to service.
I want you all to give yourselves a huge round of applause and raise the roof on this place one time. Give it up for yourselves.
We're excited to help mayors like your good mayor, Mayor Reed, to try to solve problems in this community through bringing an army of volunteers to help address those issues that are critical.
Mayor Reed spent his birthday on the links for a good cause. He joined other golfers at the Piedmont Driving Club for the 17th annual Mayor's Cup Golf Tournament. The event raises money for the mayor's youth program and provides money for Atlanta's graduating high school seniors to attend college. Former Pittsburgh Steeler Jerome Bettis took part in the tournament.
Now that I live here in Atlanta, it's my job to try to help the kids in this community. And if I can, you know, come out and use whatever celebrity I have to help influence and raise the necessary dollars that we need to help, then I'm all for it, and it's a great cause.
Congratulations to Carter Brothers Security System. They won the tournament. And from the Mayor's Cup to the World Cup, soccer fever has struck Atlanta with the beautiful game's biggest tournament kicking off. We spent some time at the Brew House where fans were already filling in ahead of the opening match between host country Brazil and Croatia.
It is going to be awesome. I think it's going to be the biggest party in history.
I want to say they're good, but they could have been better with Falcao going to the World Cup.
I mean, we got a pretty hard group with Uruguay and England, but England's a joke and Uruguay won't be too bad, but Italy's got a strong defense. We'll make it through.
Much excitement has been building around the U.S. team this year. Former German star Jurgen Klinsmann took over as manager 3 years ago and has spent his time building a stronger squad with a more offensive-minded strategy.
Defense is a little shaky, but Klinsmann's doing a good job. So I think we'll see better results than we expect. Honestly, I think we'll surprise some people for sure.
Thank you for watching City Talk. I'm Thermis Bevel.